Thank you. So I'm very happy to have you here. The purpose of my talk right now is to introduce you a bit to the EVA pre-familiarization training and proficiency training that we have put in place here at EAC. You will see a little bit more during the tour, but I just want to give you some highlights of what we do here. So basically, you know that EVA is the most challenging and the most complex activity that an astronaut can do in space. I don't know if you have noticed a tweet that was sent on the 15th of March by the NASA astronauts. They were just quoting Ray Wiseman, who did EVAs with Alexander Gerst. And during an interview, he said EVA was the most challenging and difficult things I had to do in my life. So, taking this into consideration and looking at the fact that there are not a lot of EVA opportunities, not all astronauts could do an EVA, and that's quite difficult, and a lot of astronauts are looking for an EVA during their career, their missions, NASA is selecting the astronauts based on their performance. So what's going on? During the training, they do an evaluation. They check, is this guy excellent or good? Is the guy that we can push forward to eventually assign him to an EVA? Or is this person maybe not so good for an EVA, or we need more training to push this person to be assigned for an EVA, and then an astronaut could do something else, robotics, science, piloting, something else. So now, I want to put you in the shoes of an astronaut just freshly selected. So you come to EAC, for example, you are an ESA astronaut, you might have a scuba license, but it's not mandatory because it's part of the basic training. We train astronauts in scuba just because the EVA training is done underwater. And the more at ease you are underwater, the better you will be at ease in your EVA training. Now, just imagine yourself now starting, you have a scuba experience and you start your first EVA runs. And there is actually a huge, huge gap between the experience that you can get as a diver and the experience in the suit. What happened? You are confined in a very tiny, small environment and you are confined inside for hours. So if your nose is itching, there is no way to scratch it for a bunch of hours. Your movements are limited. It's hard because the suit is inflated and created some pressure on your movement. You are isolated from the outside, and your awareness of what's going on is narrowing down to yourself. What I mean is that you lose your capability to touch because of the envelope of the suit. You lose your capability to watch around what's going on, even if you have a nice visor in front of you, you cannot turn around easily, you cannot bend to look around, and your visibility is limited. Also on the tools that you carry with you and on the surrounding. In addition, you have most of the time the nose on the structure because you have to hold yourself to an unrail. Your hearing perception is also, capability is also narrowed down because what you listen to through the Snoopy cap that you have with the headset is a communication with the ground or with the astronaut in the space station. And the rest that you hear is your breath and the noise of the ventilation in your suit. And in these conditions where you could have easily a tendency to lose the awareness of the environment, you are asked to have an increased capability to develop this additional awareness, to be always aware of what you are doing, to do a safe and efficient EVA. And these are the challenges of the EVA training. What you have to do is to develop this extra capability to always be safe and efficient. So how do you do that? You do that by learning what we call the rules of engagement of EVA. So these rules, you learn them in Houston or in Star City. These are basically rules where we guide you to be safer and more efficient. Typical easy rules like always be double secure to the structure. Everything that you carry with you needs to be either attached to you or to the structure. Other recommendations like slow is fast. What does it mean? Don't rush during your translation. It's better that you go slowly and each time you look around, where are my tools, where are my tethers, where are all the equipment that I carry with me, where do I come from, where shall I go, where is my work site, or shall I enter in the best configuration in the work site. If you rush too much, you can get entangled. You have to look at what is the problem, then you have to disentangle the mess that you have done, you lose time. Time is one of the enemy of the spacewalker. You have to be efficient and fast. In what you do, I mean. Just an example, if you have a tether that you want to put back on your mini workstation, if you put the tether in the wrong configuration, there are two possibilities, because you don't care too much, then you will have quite some difficulties to get it back, because there are movements that you cannot do. So what will happen is that your tether, you will take maybe 20 seconds, 30 seconds to get it out, where normally you can get this tether out in less than 5 seconds. So if you are not careful enough with this such a situation and you have 200 times this kind of action to do during your EVA, you will be in trouble to finish the work. So that's the reason why here at TAC, in ESA, we have developed a very unique and specific program, which is called the EVA Pre-Familiarization and Proficiency Training. And we do it in the NBF nearby, the big water tank that you have on the back. What do? We don't have any space suit here. ESA has not developed any space suit, but we don't need a space suit to train these rules of engagement. You will see, and you see on this picture, the configuration that we have for the astronauts. We mimic a little bit the working conditions, so we merge some modules. In the water, we simulate a kind of mini space station. They have to do typical EVA tasks, bringing things outside, recovering tools, attaching, doing connections, power fluid connectors, bringing things outside, from outside, inside the airlock. All the basic type of activities that you can do. And they use exactly the same tool, the same tethers that we used in Houston. So this is part of a cooperation that we had with NASA, and NASA helped us to develop this EVA pre-familiarization program. So in this configuration, with also a full face mask enabling communication with the other EVA partner, with the instructor in the control room, we train the astronauts on these rules of engagement without having the bulkiness of the suit. And after the training that they receive here, they know how to behave, they know what to do to be efficient and safe, they know how to talk, they know how to be aware, how to communicate together, how to teamwork. And the result is that when they arrive at NASA for the first training in the suit, it's easy for them. Instead of what could another astronaut who is exposed to the suit directly could feel like getting out of the first run, like, I'm not happy with what I have done. It was tiring. I got some bruises. It was uncomfortable. I did some mistakes, and I get some criticism from the instructors. I don't get good marks. I'm not really happy with what I have done. Our guys, they go there. They just have to adapt to the bulkiness and the movement limitation of the suit. But they know everything. They know what to do and how to behave. They are good and excellent. They are safe. They are efficient, and they do the first runs much faster than what is expected. Out of that, they get very good marks, even excellent marks. The NASA instructors already earmark them as, oh, these guys have a high potential for EVA. And the astronauts are then really motivated by this feedback. And as it is much easier than when they would have expected, the result is that this is a kind of boost for them. They continue to get into the training with high motivation, with pleasure, and getting out of reward out of it. The results, you have seen it. We had some recently recruited astronauts who did some EVAs. This will be also the case in the coming this year and in the coming year. So our program has been quite successful to push our guys to be assigned for an EVA. I'm coming close to 10 minutes, so it's maybe time for questions. And anyway, if you have additional questions, we can discuss it later on during the tour when we come closer to the NBF.
Thank you, Hervé. So yeah, we have 5 minutes for questions for Hervé. If you'd like to ask him anything about crew training, about the NEMO missions, about how we train astronauts to walk in space and use the ginormous swimming pool here.
Yeah, so my first question is, how do I get to swim in the pool? And, well, more seriously, how long are you generally, like on average, if you have an averagely good, trained, fit astronaut, how long do they spend training this in comparison to the real thing when they wear the real suit?
Well, the training here is a bit intensive during the basic training, before they get the first exposure to the suit. So we have something which is spread over, let's say, 1 month of training with different sessions. They start first, they have classrooms, they have familiarization with the tools. Then we do run alone for each of them. Instead of training together, two by two, as in a real EVA, we prefer them to concentrate on their task and to develop this awareness of what they do alone. And then we go to a more complex approach, where they get trained two by two, and then they have to, in addition, to develop communication and teamwork. So these are, let's say, could be 10 sessions that are spread over 1 month, and then on a regular basis, we can reactivate other sessions. We have this also as a proficiency training. That means that when an astronaut has not been exposed to EVA training for a while, 6 months, 1 year, and he's about or she's about to resume training, EVA training, either in Houston or in Star City, they have a kind of refresher training that we implement for them to put them back in the EVA state of mind. So, and then there are also periods where we don't have a lot of training activities when the astronauts are assigned to a mission, they are fully busy with their training assignment. So, and these are periods where we develop new concepts, we have new tools, we get prepared for getting better and improving our training capability for the future.
All right, we can have 3 or 4 more questions, and you can also ask Hervé questions during the tour this afternoon. Eloise, down here.
Thank you. Do you have any plans to add on a more complex situation where you add a bulky suit or a pressurized suit?
We don't want to have a pressurized suit. First of all, because the suit is extremely expensive. We talk about millions. And then you have also to maintain the suit, the different parts, and you need a lot of manpower around. So we want to be efficient and cheap to not waste the money from the taxpayers. So, but anyway, we go in a direction to improve this capability, and we are looking at possibilities to have some hardware like an exoskeleton that the astronaut could wear in the training that could be in a weight environment. It doesn't need to be pressurized, where and this exoskeleton would mimic the limitation of the suit. That's the first step, the first direction in which we are going. The second direction is that we are looking at the capability to simulate spacewalk on the moon, surface exploration on the moon or on Mars in partial gravity in the pool. And this is also something we are stepping in.
All right, next question, down the front.
If all those suits are so expensive, like real ones, how many training do they do in those suits, and how many training do they get in the more easy to move suits?
Well, the more easy to move suits, it's only here at EAC, and this is only for the ESA astronauts. The other space agencies, they don't do that. In the real suit, they are exposed. Let's say when they start, they have a kind of novice flow training, which is four runs of 6 hours together. The first one is 4 hours, and then it's 6. And then they go into the skill flow, which is about 5 runs, the same duration. And then this is a basic training that most all the astronauts get. And this is where the evaluation is done for, do you go for an EVA during your mission or not? And then when they are assigned to an EVA, they have additional 12 to 15 runs for the specific activities they will do during the EVA. So they are exposed to EVA training for around 150 hours before they go in space for the real stuff.
Awesome. And a question on the left.
What's the kind of background you as instructors have in training these astronauts? Where do you come from?
Well, I'm an aerospace engineer. I'm also a scuba instructor. I have trained astronauts for years and years, also when I was in the French Space Agency before. The background also, the additional background that you need is that you need to be trained in the suit. And I got with some of my colleagues to get the unique opportunity to be trained in at NASA in the EMU spacesuit, like our astronauts. I was also trained in the Russian spacesuit with Andreas Mogensen in 2011, where we spent 6 weeks over there for all-in training, including many runs in the pool. So you need to have this suit expertise and experience to be able to analyze what is, where are the challenges and what you have to train to help the astronauts to be better. The second aspect is that if you are not trained in the suit, you will have no credibility for the astronauts. They will not listen to you.
All right, two last questions. I saw one over here, unless there's one here, and then Daniel at the end.
A couple of months ago, they sent astronauts' legs up. I heard there was some talk about having the robot do some EVAs together with the people. Is there any training or something going on there? Will we see that in the coming years?
This might be possible, but not in the early years. I mean, in the coming years, because it's very complex. I mean, when you look at what a robot would have to master, to in terms of knowing where is the environment, what are the tasks to be done, and so on, it's extremely complex. Around 10 years ago, we did a test here in the pool with a robot which was called Eurobot. It was a prototype that we emerged in the pool. A kind of robot with three arms or three legs, let's say, with a attachment capability at each extremity. And what we tested is the capability of the robot to recognize an handrail and the location to grab it. But it was a very slow movement. I mean, to reach the handrail, it was like 20 minutes. And our environment is very simple. It would be quite challenging to have a robot mapping the full space station characteristics and structure. So, of course, on the surface, Mars, Moon, or eventually around an asteroid, this might be simpler. But we are looking forward to have cooperations. But you need human people. You need the astronauts to take the right decision, to be smart in doing the right thing at the right moment.
And final question.
Quickie, how important is the analog training, so for ESA CAVES and NASA NEMO, but also not only those two, but also any other kind of analog training?
Well, it's important, but it's not part of the official training of every astronaut. So only a few astronauts have the opportunity to get through that, and it's really bringing a lot. You will get later on during the weekend some presentation from CAVES done by Loredana, I assume. I will give you some word about my NEMO experience. This is very useful for the people who go through that, for the astronauts. This is helping them a lot to be better in their ISS mission. But not all of them could go through that.
Thank you very much. And for all the other questions that you have for Ove, he will be our NBF specialist during your tour of the Astronaut Center this afternoon, and we'll be able to show you the actual facilities and talk more about his work, and you can ask him any questions then as well.
Yes, don't hesitate to approach me if you have any questions.
He's also around for the whole space.
This is a weekend for that.
Exactly.